I want to thank AGI for organizing the webinar and for all of those that have joined us today to participate. I'm going to do the best that I can to cover a lot of ground in a short period of time, and I will talk about my research on produced water and saltwater disposal in Oklahoma and try to explain the relevant geologic conditions that affect produced water and how we manage that resource. The first slide, unfortunately, contains a lot of information, but it kind of sets the tone for my talk and will get you oriented to the state of Oklahoma, the formations of interest that are producers of oil and gas and therefore producers of produced water, salt water. And then the other slides following this will be fairly self-explanatory once you've got the groundwork. So let's start by looking at the stratigraphic column on the left side of the slide, which shows about 54 of the most prominent oil and gas producing formations in Oklahoma. You can see in the upper section we have primarily sandstone units that produce oil and gas, and they're mainly conventional types of reservoirs. In the lower sections we have carbonate units and shale units that produce oil and gas. And today, in present time, the Mississippian, the Woodford, the Devonian to Middle Ordovician, and the Arbuckle group are probably the most important in terms of the volume of water that's co-produced with oil and gas, and also as disposal zones. The Arbuckle predominantly is our disposal zone. So most of my slides will focus on those four zones and show you the trends that we see in oil and gas production, water production, and then water management. So these color codes hopefully are helpful to you. I have 10 zones that I typically will organize the data into, these 10 zones, with two miscellaneous categories that allow for younger zones or zones that are commingled together to be multiple and undifferentiated. So let's look at the chart on the bottom right to begin with to understand in the last 6.5 years what zones have been completed and the number of completions per month. So you can kind of see from this slide the color codes match the symbols on the left. The number of completions per month range from about 150 in the lowest months to as many as 375 or so completions per month. And of course, as oil prices were high and increasing, we had an increasing number of completions, specifically an increasing number in the Mississippian play in northern Oklahoma. And the Woodford has a consistent number of completions. The Devonian to Middle Ordovician has a pretty consistent number. But at the time that the price of oil dropped, you could see the number of completions per month also began to decline. And specifically, the number of completions in the Mississippian declined at that same type of rate. So this affects the produced water volume and how it changes in space and time in Oklahoma. In the upper right is the map view. The wells that were completed then started producing, some of them did, from 2009 to 2015. So it gives you a sense of where those plays were active. In northern Oklahoma, you see a lot of these blue symbols. That's the blue that corresponds to Mississippian production. And so that's the primary producing zone in northern Oklahoma. We've got the Woodford play in the Anadarko Basin. If we move down to the Devonian to Middle Ordovician completions and those wells that started producing, we have several of those in the Cherokee Platform area, the Anadarko Shelf, and even in parts of the Anadarko Basin and down into the Ardmore Basin. And then the Arbuckle Group, there aren't a whole lot of producers in the Arbuckle Group. There may be a few scattered around the state, but primarily production is occurring from the Mississippian, Woodford, and Devonian to Middle Ordovician in those recently completed wells. And that affects the water production in statewide. If I might point out one other cluster of wells, this is the Granite Wash Group, which might include the Des Moinian Age, Missourian Age, and Virgilian Age rocks. and formations. Those are prominent producers in western Oklahoma. So to set the tone there, we have those primary zones, those 10 primary zones that I organized the data into. What I want to achieve is to be able to estimate produced water volumes since they're not currently reported by operators. I have to find a method to estimate them. So I organized the oil production by zone, those same 10 zones, and look at the production over time in the chart at the bottom and in space in the map at the top. So what I'm showing here, I think, is fairly self-explanatory. Production of oil in 2009 was primarily from the upper sandstone units, and maybe it was more conventional production at that time. But as we move forward in time, we have more unconventional production and dewatering and development of some of these carbonate-rich and shale-rich zones. So production from the Mississippian of oil certainly has increased as activity and completions increased in that zone. And then Woodford shale production, even though it's primarily a gas zone, there is oil production that has increased as well. It's interesting to look at what occurred after the price of oil dropped. The production of oil also has decreased. So we have to continue to complete new wells and develop new wells to maintain the same level of oil production. If we look at the map view, you can see where oil production was at its highest at a county scale. Woods County, Alfalfa County, that's and Osage County, that's primarily Mississippian oil production. And then in the south, maybe Stevens and Carter County, the darker shades, would be a combination of Woodford, Devonian to Middle Ordovician, Simpson Group probably in that area, Springer and some other zones. And then the Granite Wash, those younger sandstone-rich layers would produce oil in western Oklahoma. Gas trends look a little bit different statewide, and you can see back in 2009 we were producing most of the gas from the younger sandstone units, but over time the Woodford specifically has really been developed, so a lot of gas production from the Woodford. And the downturn in oil prices really hasn't affected gas production a whole lot. It looks like it's been pretty consistent since the price of oil dropped. If you look at the map view, you can see the primary gas production zones are in the Ardmore Basin, I'm sorry, the Arkoma Basin, and then in the Anadarko Basin in areas of Oklahoma where gas has been produced in recent years. Some gas production in the north from the Mississippian and other units. So what does it mean in terms of water production? The approach that I've been using to estimate produced water really starts with understanding which zones produce oil and gas, and then computing from initial potential tests and production tests a ratio of water to oil and water to gas, and then using that as a multiplier to estimate co-produced water volumes. So trying to achieve co-produced water volumes by a scientifically defensible method, this is the approach that I use. What's shown in this foreground chart is the ratio of water to oil, and then inter-50 percentile, 25th percentile up to 75th percentile, with the median where the light color meets the dark color. So this is the ratio or the range of ratios that I would expect to see in a variety of tests that are done by zone. The median value is listed on the left. So as a starting point, if I wanted to estimate co-produced water volumes, I could take oil production from a specific zone, multiply it by the median, and I would have a ballpark figure for produced water volume. I have the same data in the background here for water to gas ratios, and again, apply the same methodology. So what I've done in recent weeks is try to refine this methodology and calibrate produced water estimates to the saltwater disposal volumes that I've been tabulating over the same period of time. And so the stars that you see on the slides represent the ratios that I think are most consistent or give me the best fit to the saltwater disposal volumes. So after calibration, so to speak, the ratios, for example, in the Mississippian, the ratio of water to oil appears to be much higher. It gives me a better fit in my model. And the ratio of water to gas in the Devonian to Middle Ordovician, which includes the Hunton, and even water to oil in the Devonian to Middle Ordovician is much higher. So that tells me that based on this approach, the produced water volumes will be much higher in areas that are producing from the Mississippian and the Devonian to Middle Ordovician. So that plays itself out pretty clearly in this slide, which shows again the time scale or temporal scale in the bottom in the chart. Back in 2009, our production from the Devonian to Middle Ordovician really made up the majority of the produced water, generated the majority of the produced water. As the production shifted to Mississippian and still included Devonian to Middle Ordovician, the water production from the Mississippian certainly increased and became the majority of our produced water. After the downturn, the oil prices change. That affects water production as operators shift from maybe water producing zones to lower water producing zones. And we see an estimate of produced water that's also declining in recent months. So in map view, you can see the summary, Woods County, Alfalfa County, major water production zones. That's Mississippian production. And then in central Oklahoma, Oklahoma County, Lincoln County, Seminole County, that's where we have a lot of Devonian to Middle Ordovician production and probably Hunton dewatering activity that's associated with that. So what do we do with produced water once it comes out of the ground? This is a portion of a diagram that I've drawn that shows flow of water through the oil and gas sector. And this is the portion that I'm talking about today, produced water. In many cases, operators are treating it to clean brine and reusing it for frack jobs and additional drilling and completion. In other cases, we may use it for enhanced oil recovery and water floods, which you saw in this diagram to the bottom. But today I'm going to summarize or wrap up my talk with where does the water go and into saltwater disposal wells, specifically in Oklahoma. So produced water is largely generated, it seems, in the Mississippian play in northern Oklahoma and Devonian to Middle Ordovician group in central Oklahoma with some other pockets of high water production. But where does it go back into the subsurface in saltwater disposal wells? The same zones that I showed earlier, now showing saltwater disposal, and the dominant zone for saltwater disposal in Oklahoma is the Arbuckle. So we take water out of the Mississippian, Devonian to Middle Ordovician primarily, and then it goes back into the Arbuckle. And so because the Arbuckle is so overwhelming in terms of the volume of saltwater disposal, I'd like to look at that as a separate slide and show you the distribution of Arbuckle disposal wells, which are mostly in the Anadarko Shelf region or province and the Cherokee Platform geologic province. In other areas, the Arbuckle is either very deep or not present. So the Arbuckle disposal wells really correspond to zones that I've estimated to have the highest produced water volumes. So the increase in produced water volumes over time do correlate pretty strongly with the increase in saltwater disposal into the Arbuckle. To wrap it up, I have a few take-home messages for you. Dewatering in Oklahoma seems to yield more produced water than unconventional shale development. The Woodford Shale is obviously a prominent gas-producing zone, but it's not a big water producer. our water production really comes from those carbonates. And the rate of water production, I think, is strongly related to the market. So oil prices drop, operators will move away from water, essentially. To allow for us to improve our ability to recycle and reuse water, we do need some regulatory controls and help and innovation. So pooling is one of the strategies that we really need to begin to adopt here in Oklahoma. And if we want to use or reuse water outside of the oil and gas industry, desalination is one of the requirements. That salty water needs to be desalinated and reused elsewhere. And in terms of saltwater disposal and how we manage that resource, the cost is really largely a function of how far we move the water before it's disposed. So the operation and maintenance cost really is tied up in transport of that water. Thank you for your time. I look forward to your questions.